This question is from GATE 2017, set number 2 paper, okay? And this question is belongs to operating system. So, coming to the question statement, which of the following is are shared by all the threads of all the threads in the same process? Statement 1, program counter. Statement 2, stack. Statement 3, address space. And statement 4, registers. Option A, one and two only, option B, three only, option C, four only, and option D, three and four only. Right. So coming to this question, it is mentioned that which of the following is are shared by all the threads in a process. Shared by all the threads in a process. It means that a process is having multiple threads. Means that we are speaking about multi-threaded process. So let's consider that multi-threaded process diagram. So coming to multi-threaded process diagram. So multi-threaded process means the process which is having more than one thread. Okay. If it is single threaded process, the process which is having single thread. Right. So coming to multi-threaded process diagram. So here we can have code section, data section, and files. So these are the three parts of a process can be shared by all the related threads of that particular process. So this is what a thread 1, and this is what thread 2, and this is what thread 3. So this thread is maintaining its own stack pointer, register set, and program counter. And this thread also maintains its own stack pointer, register set, and program counter. And this thread also maintains its own stack pointer, register set, and program counter. So according to the question, which of the following are shared by all the threads of the process? So here it is mentioned that one is program counter, two is stack, and four is register. So these three are not shared among the threads of the process. They are private. They are individual with respect to each thread of a process. But which is sharing? So among the four, one, two, four, these are the four sections are private to the thread. Means that they are not getting shared. What is else? Third one, which is address space. So address space can be shared by all the threads of a same process. So address space, which is three. Three only can be shared among the all the threads of the same process. Hence, the answer for this question is option B. So only three, which is address space only gets shared among the multiple threads of the same process. The remaining all the parts are private with respect to each thread. Okay. So hence, the final answer for this question is option B. Thank you. This question is from GATE 2017 set number 2 paper. And this question belongs to operating system part. So coming to the question statement, in a file allocation system, which of the following allocation schemes can be used if no external fragmentation is allowed? If no external fragmentation is allowed. Statement, first one, contiguous. Second one, linked. Third one, indexed. Option A, 1 and 3. Option B, 2 only. Option C, 3 only. And option D, 2 and 3 only. So here, we need to know what is external fragmentation. Okay, so external fragmentation. So first one, we are going to see contiguous file allocation. So for example, if it is my disk, so this disk is having some disk blocks like this. So I have a file descriptor table which is showing the file name as A. And it is also showing starting disk block address, and it is also saying size of that particular file with respect to number of blocks. So for example, the starting disk block address is 1 and the size of the disk block is, for example, 4. So it means that, so let's suppose this is my 0, 1, 2, these are the disk block addresses, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So now, it is saying that from 1, 4 blocks. And you know, in this contiguous file allocation technique, for a file, the continuous blocks can be allocated. That's why the title is contiguous. So it means that from 1, continuously 4 disk blocks are used to save this particular A file. So means that here I can have A.C file, here I can have A.C file, here I can have A.C, and here I can have A.C. So for example, the file name is A.C. So continuously, in four disk blocks from one, continuously 4 disk blocks we have occupied this particular A.C. Okay, so then coming to the next file, which is let's say B.C. So the B.C disk block, starting disk block address is 4 and it is also having 4 size. So it means that B.C file also I should allocate for 4 continuous blocks. So means that B.C is starting from 5 and 6, 7 and 8. So total 4 blocks continuously it also occupied. Then in this case I want to extend this particular A.C file. I want to extend this A.C file size. One disk block is free here, but am I able to utilize this particular disk block? No, because contiguous. So this A.C file is saved from 1, 2, 3, 4. It has saved among 1, 2, 3, 4 disk blocks. So if I want to extend this A.C file, compulsory I should go for 5. But 5 is already filled. So means that I can't go to the 0th disk block. So since for that reason, this 0th disk block is going to be wasted forever. So this wastage is said to be external fragmentation. This is what external fragmentation, which is happening in contiguous. So coming to, let's suppose, linked allocation. So coming to the linked allocation, these are the disk blocks I have. And the file descriptor table is saying that file name, starting disk block address and ending disk block address. So A.C file I have, the starting disk block address is 1 and ending disk block address is, let's suppose, 5. So it means that, so this is my 1, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. These are the disk block addresses here. And starting disk block address of A is 1. So and in this linked allocation, as we know that each disk block maintains a pointer. Each disk block maintains a pointer. Each disk block maintains a pointer to save the next block on which, the next block address on which this particular file is saved. You know, linked list. So linked list. So you are having data field and address field towards the next link. So similarly, this is my first disk block in which A.C file is saved. Then after accessing that, then if I go to the pointer, this pointer may points to third disk block. So means that in the third disk block I have A.C file. Now once I have seen, once I fill this A.C file, then if I go to this pointer of the third disk block, then it may point to the sixth disk block. Then in the sixth disk block I can have A.C file. So if I, after filling that sixth disk block with A.C file, then if I refer the pointer, this pointer may point to the fifth disk block, and in which I can have A.C file, and it is the last disk block of A. And coming to the B.C file, it is starting from 2, for example, and it is ending with 8. So means that second disk block we have allocated to the B. Then if I have seen that the pointer, this pointer have shown me fourth disk block. So in this fourth disk block also we are saving the B.C file. Then this B.C file, then this fourth disk block pointer is pointing towards the seventh disk block. So in which I can save B.C file. After saving that b.c file in the 7th disk block, then if I go to the pointer of the 7th disk block, this pointer of showing 8th disk block address. So, in which I can save b.c file. Now, 0th disk block is free. So, if I want to extend the a.c file, then am I able to save it, or am I able to extend it or not? In contiguous, since contiguous blocks are there, the extension of file sizes depends on the next free block. But here it is not the case. Whichever block is free, I can easily utilize it. How can I utilize is, what is the last disk block of a.c? 5. Then if I go to the 5, and you know the last node of a linked list contains the address as null. So now since this is the 5th disk block, this address contains null. So I can remove this null and I can point to the 0th disk block. So then in which I can save a.c file. So means that no disk block is going to get wasted here. So that's why in linked allocation, we don't have external fragmentation. But in contiguous allocation, we are having external fragmentation. And coming to indexed. Coming to indexed, this is what my disk block. So the main difference between this indexed allocation and linked allocation is, here you have seen for each disk block you have maintained a pointer, but here it is not the case. We can choose only one disk block to save all the pointers of the same file. So then, for example, if I consider a.c file, so here the file descriptor table of indexed allocation can contains file name and inode. So a.c file inode is 5. Let's say this is 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 and 8. So a.c file inode is 5. So if I go to the 5, then with respect to the a.c file, which disk blocks we have allocated is 2, 1, 3, 6, like that. And if I go to the b.c file, okay, if I go to the b.c file, if 8th disk block is the indexed node for the b.c file, then this 8th disk block also contains the list of disk block addresses on which b.c file is saved. So what else remaining? 4 is remaining, 7 is remaining. So 1, a.c file is here, a.c file is here, a.c file is here, and 6, this is also. So now we are having pending with only 4 and 7. Among these two disk block addresses we have saved in the inode of the b.c file. Now if I want to extend the file, of a.c file, then I can simply add this disk block address to the inode. So means that here also we are not going to waste any disk block. So hence we can say in this indexed allocation also we don't have external fragmentation. So in which file allocation techniques we don't have external fragmentation? Only linked and indexed. But we are facing external fragmentation in contiguous. Hence the answer is linked and indexed, which is matching with option D. Option D, which is specifying that 2 and 3. Okay, so hence the answer for this question is option D. Thank you. This question is from GATE 2017 set number 2 paper, and this question belongs to operating system. So coming to the question statement, a system shares 9 tape drives. The current allocation and maximum requirement of tape drives for 3 processes are shown below. Like process ID is given P1, P2, P3 and current allocation is given 313 and maximum requirement it is given 765. Which of the following best describes current state of the system? Option A, safe and deadlocked. Option B, safe and not deadlocked. Option C, not safe, deadlocked. Option D, not safe, not deadlocked. So coming to the question statement, coming to the system, so here it is mentioned that 3 processes, P1, P2, P3, and current allocation is given. So current allocation also given, which is 313. And maximum requirement also given, maximum demand or maximum requirement is given as 7, 6 and 5. So here we want to say describe the current state of the system, whether it is safe state or not, means deadlocked or not. So for that, So to check with this deadlock, we use an algorithm called Banker's algorithm. So Banker's algorithm is used for deadlock avoidance. So according to the Banker's algorithm, we need four data structures. The four data structures are current allocation, maximum demand, available matrix, and need matrix. So among these four, two are given in the question statement. Now we are going to see need matrix. So as we know that need of a process, or how I can calculate, is maximum demand minus current allocation. So 7 minus 3, 4, 6 minus 1, 5, 5 minus 3, 2. This is the need of each process out of this much and after allocation of this much. So current allocation defines the number of resources that are allocated currently to the process. Maximum demand means what is the maximum number of resource requirement of a process. Out of this much is allocated. After this much allocation, still this much requirement is there for each and every process. And according to the question, it is mentioned that a system shares total 9 number of tape drives. So among the 9 number of tape drives, 3 plus 3, 6, 6 plus 1, 7. So 7 are currently allocated. Means that I am having still 2 number of resources as available. So now what is my available matrix is 2. So if I am able to satisfy all the 3 processes need with this available, then I can say I am in safe state. So if the system is in safe state, no deadlock. If the system is in unsafe state, then deadlock is possible. Okay, so that is what. So with that particular scenario, first we are going to apply Banker's algorithm on system. So according to the Banker's algorithm, first we need to choose process P1, and one process we need to choose, and we need to check the process need is less than or equals to available or not. So what is the need of that particular process P1? 4. But what is available? 2, which is false statement. So what is the meaning of false is process P1 is not yet completed here. So in the first iteration, let's say this is my cycle 1 of Banker's algorithm execution on these 3 processes. So in first iteration or in the first cycle, P1 is not yet completed. Now coming to the P2. So the P2 need is less than or equals to available. What is the need of P2? 5. But what is available? 2. So it means that P2 also cannot satisfy. Means that P2 also cannot be completed. Then coming to process P3. Process P3 need is less than or equals to available. What is the need? 2. Is less than or equals to what is available? 2. So which is the condition? Statement is true. This condition statement is true. So since it is true, what we are going to do is work equals to work plus allocation. So what is it? Work is, according to the Banker's algorithm, the initial value of work is available. So all the available we are saving into the work. Okay. So work plus allocation. So what is work? 2. Because available is 2. So 2 plus allocation. So since P3 is getting completed with this available, after completion of P3, whatever the allocation is there with respect to the P3, that should be make available to the rest of processes. So that's why the allocation of P3, after completion of P3, whatever the resources we have allocated to the P3, they should add to the available, because we are going to make the current allocation of P3 as available to the rest of processes. So that's why the current allocation should be added to the available. So then it becomes 2 plus, so available is 2, and so let's say available which is saved in the work, so that is 2, and what is the allocation of P3? 3. So then it becomes 5. So since this P3 is completed in the safe sequence, I can add P3 first. So safe sequence, what do you mean by safe sequence? In the sense, it shows in which order the processes gets completed. So P3 is completed first, then the updated available is 5, then cycle number 2 is executing. So means that again process P1 on process P1 and process P2, we need to apply Banker's algorithm. So then need is less than or equals to available. So what is the need of P1? What is the need of P1? 4. Is less than or equals to what is the current available? 5. So true. So since it is true, whatever the current allocation of P1 is there, that should be make available to the P2. So that's why work equals to work plus allocation. What is the work? Available. What is available? 5 plus what is allocation of P1? 3. So 5 plus 3, 8. So means that after P3 is completed, then P1 also gets completed. Then we are coming to P2, second cycle. So this P2 need, what is the need of P2? 5. Is less than or equals to, what is the current available now? 8. Which is true. So since it is true, work equals to work plus allocation. So what is the meaning of true is, we can complete, we can satisfy the P2. We can satisfy P1. We can satisfy P3. That is what the meaning of true or false. If it is false, we can't satisfy. If it is true, we can satisfy. Okay. So what is the work here? 8. Plus what is the allocation of P2? 1. So 8 plus 1, 9. So then P2 can be added to the safe sequence. So since I am getting the safe sequence, we can say the system is in safe state. The system is in safe state. So if the system is in safe state, we can say no deadlock. Okay, so if the system is in unsafe state, then deadlock is possible. So there is a statement. What is that statement is? All unsafe states may lead to the deadlock, but all the deadlock states are unsafe states only. Okay, so but here it is safe state. So since it is safe state, there is no deadlock. So this is what one safe sequence. And there can be another safe sequence. We are not saying that the safe sequence is unique. So the safe sequences can be multiple. So what is the second safe sequence is, anyway first P3 has to be completed. After P3, what is the available? 5. With this 5, P2's need 5. This can be satisfied. Means that after P3, P2 can be completed and then P1. So this is one safe sequence and this is one safe sequence. So anyway, overall, since we are getting the safe sequence with respect to this system is in safe state as well as it is not deadlocked, which is matching with option B. So the answer for this question is option B. Thank you. This question is from GATE 2017, set number 2 question paper. So this question belongs to operating system. So coming to the question statement, consider the set of processes with arrival times in milliseconds and CPU burst time in milliseconds. And the priority is 0 is highest priority shown below. None of the processes have I/O burst. Okay. So the average waiting time in milliseconds of all the processes using preemptive priority scheduling algorithm is. So this is what the question statement. So let's consider the question statement. I mean the system state. What is that system state is? The system is mentioning that there are 5 processes: P1, P2, P3, P4, and P5. And arrival times are given. So arrival times are like 0, 5, 12. 0, 5, 12, 2 and 9. And burst time also given. So the burst time of all these processes is 11, 28, 2, 10 and 16. Additionally, priority also given. So what is the priority of all these 5 processes is 2, 0, 3, 1, 4. And as per the question, it is clearly mentioned that 0 is the higher priority. So means that smaller number implies higher priority and larger number implies lower priority. And here we are implementing priority preemptive scheduling algorithm. So preemptive priority. So let's have some idea about this, how the preemption can be happened here. Preemptive priority scheduling algorithm. So for example, this is a CPU and this is a ready queue. At time t0, let's suppose P1 is executing on the CPU with some priority. at time t0, P1 is executing currently with some priority. And just now, while this P1 is in execution, just now P2 is arrived into the ready queue with some priority. So, the newly arrived process priority and the currently running process priority both can be compared. If the newly arrived process priority is higher than the currently running process priority, then preemption takes place. Means that P1 can be added back to the ready queue and P2 can be handed over to the CPU. When the priority of the currently running process is greater than or higher than the currently running process priority. Okay. So, this is what the fundamental basic idea behind solving of this particular question. So, coming to the Gantt chart for this system, using priority preemptive scheduling algorithm, at 0, P1 is arrived with 2 priority. So, since it is the only one process in the ready queue, by 0, it can be handed over to the CPU. And this can be continued till the next arrival. What is the next arrival? 2. So, till 2, it can be executed. So, then by 2, P1 is currently running with priority 2 and P4 is arrived with priority 1. So, since P4 is arrived, by 2, P1 is in running state and P4 is arrived. So, P4 is arrived here. Let's suppose P4 is arrived here and P1 is currently running. So, what is the P1 priority? 2. And what is the currently running process? That is P1, its priority is 2. And what is the newly arrived process? That is P4, its priority is 1. So, smaller number implies higher priority. So, comparatively 2, 1 is smaller. So, means that 1 is greater than 2 with respect to the priority. So, that's why preemption takes place. Means that P1 can be added to the ready queue and P4 can be handed over to the CPU. So, means P4 can be handed over to the CPU. So, this can be executed till 5. So, till the next arrival. What is the next arrival? Till 5. So, by 5 in the ready queue, P1 is there in the ready queue and P4 is currently running with 1 priority, and by 5, who is arrived? P2 is arrived. So, P2 is arrived with 0 priority. So, now P4 is in currently running state and P2 is arrived. So, P4 is currently running with priority 1 and P2 is just arrived with priority 0. So, the currently running process is P4 which is having the priority 1 and the newly arrived process is P2 which is having priority 0. So, 0 is the higher priority. So, means that 0 is greater than 1 with respect to the priorities. Hence, preemption takes place. Means that P2 can be handed over to the CPU and P4 can be added back to the ready queue. So, means that P2 can be handed over to the CPU. So, since it is a higher priority process, it gets completely executed. Okay, so or else you can do one thing, that is till 9 next arrival. What is the next arrival? 9. So till 9 you can execute this P2. So then by this moment P1 is there in the ready queue with priority 2 and P4 is there in the ready queue with priority 1. Okay, by 9 P2 is currently running with priority 0. Okay. And by 9, who is arrived? P5 is arrived. So, P5 is arrived with how much burst time? How much priority? 4. So, P2 is having 0 priority which is higher and P5 is just arrived with priority 4 which is lower. So, means that the currently running process priority is still having higher priority than the newly arrived process priority. So, that no preemption. Means that P2 can be continued. So, this P2 can be continued till the next arrival. What is the next arrival? 12. So, till 12, P2 can be continued. So, by this moment, P1 is there in the ready queue with priority 2. P4 is also there in the ready queue with priority 4 or priority 1. And P2 is currently running with priority 0. And P5 is there with priority 4 in the ready queue. And just now, P3 is arrived with priority 3. So, the currently running process is P2 and the newly arrived process is P3. So, the currently running process priority is 0 and the newly arrived process priority is 3. So, 3 is lower than this particular one. So, means that the currently running process priority is still having higher priority than the newly added process priority, which is P3, so that no preemption means that P2 can be continue. So till now this P2 have executed here 4 units, here 3 units. So total 4 plus 3, 7 units is over out of 28. So 7 units is over out of 28. So then still it is having 21. So that 21 gets executed now. So 21 plus 12, 33. So till 33, P2 gets executed. So by this 33, in the ready queue I have P1 with priority 2, in the ready queue I have P4 with priority 1, in the ready queue I have P5 with priority 4, and in the ready queue I have P3 with priority 3. So among these ready queue processes, which process is having higher priority? P4. So that's why P4 can be handed over to the CPU. So this P4, previously 3 units is executed. What is the total execution time of P4? 10. Out of 10, 3 is executed here, so still it is having 7. So that 7 gets executed now. So till 40, it gets executed. Now, by this 40, P2 is there in the ready queue with priority 2, P5 is there with priority 4, and P3 is there with priority 3. Among these 3 processes, P1 has higher priority, so that P1 can hand over to the CPU. This P1 total execution time is 11. Out of 11, previously 2 units is executed, still it is having 9. So that 9 gets executed now. So 40 plus 9, 49. So by 49, P5 is there in the ready queue with priority 4, and P3 is there with priority 3. So among these 2 processes, P3 has higher priority, so that P3 handed over to the CPU. So this P3 previously not yet executed, this is the first execution. So what is the total execution time of P3? 2. So till 51 it gets executed. So by 51 I have process P5 with priority 4. So till now with respect to this P5 also not yet get executed. What is the burst time of P5? 16. What is the burst time of P5? 16. So that total 16 gets executed now. So 51 plus 16. So 51 plus 16, which is 67. So 67. Okay. So right. So this is what the respective Gantt chart for this system. So now what we are going to do is, as per the question, we need to calculate average waiting time. So for that, first we need to calculate completion time, turnaround time, and then only we can calculate waiting time. So that's why first we are coming to completion time of each process. So P1 is completed at 49, P2 is completed at 33, P4 is completed at 40, and P3 is completed at 51. P3 is completed at 51. So P1 is completed at 49. P2 is completed at 33, okay, and P3 is completed at 51, and P4 is completed at 40, and P5 is completed at 67. Then coming to turnaround time. So completion time minus arrival time. So 49 minus 0, 49, 33 minus 5, 28, 51 minus 12, which is 39, 40 minus 2, 38, 67 minus 9, which is 58. So this is what the turnaround time of each process. Then waiting time, which is time difference between turnaround time and burst time. So 49 minus 11, which is 38, 28 minus 28, which is 0, 39 minus 2, which is 37, 37, and 38 minus 10, 28, 58 minus 16, 42. Okay, so 42. So now, therefore, average waiting time is equals to, so have a calculation. So 42 plus 28, which is 70, 70 plus 38 plus 37, which is 75. So total 145. So 145 by 5. So total average waiting time, total waiting time is 145 by, since it is average, 5. So then how much it is? So 145 by 5, 5 2s are 10, 45, 5 9s are. So it means that 29 milliseconds is the average waiting time for this system. So the answer for this question is 29. Okay? So thank you.